letting us come here tonight to dedicate this time to you. Thank you for South Idaho just opening up their gym to allow us to have this. I pray that as we go in tonight, we just go in with open and heavy hearts for you, Lord, and that you would just speak through each and every individual that walks on this court, whether it's Matt and Abby, Matt and Josh, or a student just giving their testimony, God. I pray that you would just speak to them and the two other students, and I thank you for everything you do, and we love you so, so much. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Struggling to keep your focus on God or to find your purpose, that you will just surrender it all to Him and let Him guide you.
That's in my life. God did so much for me that He opened up my eyes and taught me how to be a light in the world. After that camp, I got my Bible book. I joined FCA at West Idaho. I started going to youth and church every Sunday. It was truly amazing. I would just like to thank God for everything He's done. Get me to that camp, everything's done for me at FCA. Kendall King and Eli Josie for being such important people in fact in my life before after that camp. I truly thank them enough for everything they've done for me. Also, I'd like to thank Parker and Brian and everyone else that got me to this point in my life.
Grace and mercy in giving us chances to serve Him. So every opportunity that you have, don't pass up a chance to tell someone about Jesus, because you never know when it's too late. So all you students, if you don't know the Lord, if you have that opportunity tonight, which you will, please take it, because you never know.
Lost and broken, and you just came here because a friend invited you and you have no idea what you're getting yourself into. God said that you would have troubles no matter who you are right now. But the great amazing thing about that is that He says He has overcome those problems. Every single problem that you're having in your life right now, all of those, like I said, responsibilities that you're so scared of, He has already had you overcome, and He's already seen that problem out, because God had every single part of your life planned out from the moment you were born.
If you live for the Lord, He will provide. But you can't ask, you can't question why God isn't working in your life if you're never spending any time with Him.
The thing is, God never promised you that it was going to be easy. God never promised you that your walk was going to be easy. But He did promise He would be there with you every single step of the way.
The dictionary defines identity by who we are, but the Bible defines identity by whose we are. So do not let these things hinder your relationship with God.
Revelation 21, 4 through 5 says, "And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, or crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he sat upon his throne and said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said unto me, "For these words are true and faithful."
And so as I sat there looking at Abigail and my wife, we just prayed, "God, just, you've done so much." I mean, her heart, it stopped. You know, we heard the doctor say, "This is not going to be the same girl. She's going to live with these issues and those issues, and you've overcome all of that. Can you go a step further?" Because we don't want her to be so self-aware and self-conscious about these scars. And we were praying about it. And Abigail, about a week or two in, I can't remember, she said, "Dad, I need to talk to you." She texted me because we had pulled her down to the main floor of the house, and she was upstairs before, and I said, "Okay," and I come down. She said, "I got to tell you this dream that I had." I said, "Okay, what's the dream?" She said, "I was dreaming, and you know the woman in the New Testament where she went to pray for Jesus and she's weeping at his feet, and she dries his feet with the hairs of her head?" And I said, "Yeah." She said, "That's what I was doing. I guess I was in heaven because Jesus was in the throne. It's a big chair. I'm guessing it's the throne," she says. It was funny. And she says, "I'm crying." And she said, "Jesus bent over from his throne and picked my face up. And he reached down and he kissed me right on the scar in my forehead. And he said this to me, 'Your scars are beautiful just like mine, because they tell your story.'" Why are you saying all of this tonight? Because all of us, I don't care if you're 2 or 102 in this place, have dealt with some sort of trauma. It could be family trauma. It could be relational trauma. It could be something that has happened in school. It could be big decisions that some of you have growing up. But I know that all of us, including yours truly, have dealt with a place of brokenness. You want to come? Yeah, you want to come play? A place of brokenness in our lives. The good thing about Jesus is when he finds broken vessels, as Abigail said, the Revelation doesn't say that he makes all new things. He makes all things new. If he made all new things, he discards broken things and just makes something else new in its place. But that's not what it says. It says he makes all things new. That means he takes broken things and broken hearts and broken people, and he mends them back together with his immense love that he has for every single one of you. Brennan Manning said years ago, "I could more easily contain Niagara Falls in a teacup than I could contain the uncontrollable, uncontainable love of God." And he has that for every single person in this place. And some of you have never said to him, "Jesus, I want you to come in. I want you to bring that gold and mix it in with my brokenness. Gold speaks of divinity. I want you to take the blood that was shed on my behalf, and I want you to intermingle it and tie it into the story of my life." Tonight, I think this could be your night to say, "This is the night that I'm going to have Jesus come and by his blood make me a new creation. Make me a new creature. Not discard me because I'm broken, but make me more beautiful than I could have been before." Some of you have dealt with family trauma. Some of it I know and some of it I don't know. And you think because of that brokenness, that thing that you push down deep and you don't talk about a whole lot and you don't dare even communicate, Jesus sees it and he loves you enough that he wants to come and meet you in that very place. I've watched miracle upon miracle. I've seen them, but I've never seen them more than I've seen the last 3 months of my own daughter, with the healing of her legs and the healing of her brain and all the other stuff. What I would like to see on January 25th is the miracle of someone saying, "I want to ask Jesus Christ to become my Savior, to take the broken heart, the broken thing, the broken pieces of my life, and do what only he can do, because the truth is, he's the only one that can do it." A lot of you have asked him into your heart, but your heart has become hardened because of situation. It happens. This happens. We live in this thing called life. If we can be real, we would all say, "Yeah, man." Tonight could be the night we say, "Afresh again, Holy Spirit. Save me again. Redeem me again. Pour your Spirit out upon me again." I cannot think of a better way to use the testimony of God bringing my daughter back from the dead and bringing his own son Jesus back from the dead than for you to say, "You know what? I'm willing to give my life. I'm willing to give this Jesus thing a shot. Can you come and take the broken things of my life and make it new?" We've got a whole team of people standing across here. We've got some in the balconies or some in the stands that would like to pray with you. If you're in a place now where you're dealing with a broken area that you want Jesus to come in and touch you, because he wants to do that and shed that love and share the same miraculous power that he shed for Abby and for all of these speakers over here. If that's you, I want you to come down here on the floor right now. Right now. Just go ahead and turn it into a church service. This is about Jesus anyway. There's no need to be nervous because we've all been here. Some of you would like to say, look, I've been saved before, but I've moved away from Christ. I've lost my way. And tonight can be a night that you find it again. If that's you, I want you to come down here. Right down here in the front. Come on. Don't wait. Come on down. Here they come. Come on.